Thank you. So first, we'd like to thank the conference organizers. I know putting together a conference is never easy, especially in these COVID times. So thank you very much for all the work that the coordinators are doing. And Diana and I are here today to talk about teaching with Wikipedia in the classroom. And before we launch into that, we do want to read the land acknowledgement statement for our university. Let it be acknowledged that Oregon State University in Corvallis, Oregon, is located within the traditional homelands of the Marys River or Ampanefu Band of Kalapuya. Following the Willamette Valley Treaty of 1855, Kalapuya people were forcibly removed to reservations in Western Oregon. Today, living descendants of these people are a part of the Confederated Tribes of Grand Ronde Community of Oregon and the Confederated Tribes of the Siletz Indians. Today, we are talking about Wikipedia, but this is our first UK conference. And although I have given some presentations in Spain, we thought maybe we should give some context about us and then about our particular university and our setting. So I am Laurie Bridges, and I am an instruction and outreach librarian at Oregon State. I am at faculty status, so I'm an associate professor. The department I'm in is called Teaching and Engagement. And I've been a librarian for 15 years, and I'm a liaison to the School of Writing, Literature, and Film, Arts and Communication, and then also International Services and Programs.
Hi, everyone. My name is Diana Park. My pronouns are she and hers. And I am a science librarian here at OSU. I am the liaison to our College of Science. That's our life sciences, some of our physical sciences, and I work with a lot of undergraduates, some graduate students and faculty. I am an assistant professor. I have not made tenure yet, but hopefully in a few years. And I'm also part of the teaching and engagement department, as Laurie is. And I've been a librarian and at OSU, so this is my first librarian position for almost 3 years now. So it'll be 3 years this summer.
Okay, so a little bit about our university. Oregon State University is a public university, and we were founded in 1868. We're located in Corvallis, Oregon. So if you know anything about the west coast of the US, we are an hour and a half south of Portland, Oregon, 4 hours south. We always say with drives, 4 hours drive south of Seattle. Our student enrollment is 32,000. And I want you to know that is actually quite a jump from when I started at the university. I didn't start as a librarian. I actually started in the field of student affairs. So when I came to this university in 1997, we were only 13,000. So we have grown a lot in the past 20 years. Currently, out of the 32,000 students, 8,915 identify as BIPOC, which is Black, Indigenous, and people of color. In the US, we focus a lot of attention on first generation college students. So 23% of our undergraduate students are first generation, meaning neither of their parents has a degree. And 71% of the students here are residents of Oregon. So the others would be students outside of this state or international students. And then today we're going to be talking about a class that we teach as part of the Honors College. And we thought it was important to just talk about what the Honors College is, because I do believe it's rather unique to the US system. Almost, I would assume every large public university has some type of honors college. Our honors college is approximately 1,600 students, and these students apply to be in the honors college, and once they're admitted to the Honors College, they have smaller classes. So they have access to smaller class sizes than other students. And then they do a thesis, which other undergraduate students do not do a thesis. And then these students also take part in colloquium classes. And colloquiums are usually 1 or 2 credits, and they have to take a total of 6 credits. And each year there's an application process for instructors and professors to propose colloquium classes. What I want to say about the colloquium classes is they're often very experimental, they're unique. And it kind of, I guess I would say a nice thing is you don't have to, as a faculty member, go through the bureaucracy of the university. Normally, proposing a new class at the university would take quite some time. I would guess even up to a year or more. And you have to go through a committee. It's quite a multi-level process. But when you teach a class in the Honors College for the colloquium, there's just a small committee within the Honors College, and they say yes or no, and then you move forward with teaching the class. So this would be our 3rd year teaching this class. But to give you some idea of the kind of quirky classes they're often offered, we've put a link in our presentation. So you could just look through the list if you want to see what kind of classes are colloquium classes. So this class that we are talking about is a colloquium class. I first applied to teach it in 2018 and was approved, and then we've reapplied every year. Actually, before we go on, are there any questions about the context of Oregon State or US librarianship, teaching, faculty status, before we discuss the class? Okay, if there are any questions, feel free to put them in the chat. If I'm talking, Diana will happily answer questions. And if she's talking, then I'll answer questions. So we're going to launch into the conversation about the class that we teach. So the class is currently called, we've changed the name recently, the class is currently called Wikipedia and Information Equity. And it's Honors College 407. So I'll begin at the very beginning, which is that I've only been involved with Wikipedia as a teaching tool and in the classroom since 2018. And what happened was that in 2018, my son, who at the time was 9, was in class, and he started coming home and talking excitedly about a project he was working on in class. And after a few days of his excitement, which included songs and information about other countries, I started asking more about this assignment. And the assignment was every student in his class had to select a frog from somewhere in the world, and they would be giving a presentation on their frog. And the presentation had to include information about the habitat and the country the frog was located in. Some of the students were writing songs about the frog, so I got to hear some interesting frog songs. And then also I'll mention that his school, elementary school, is dual immersion, English and Spanish. So in the dual immersion, that means that the teacher 1 week does all of school in English, the next week all Spanish, the next week all English, the next week all Spanish. So up until this point of my son coming home, I had not really considered Wikipedia other than telling students you could use the references at the bottom of every page. But when he came home talking about it at age 9 and told me they were using Wikipedia for this assignment and only Wikipedia, I started contemplating, If 9-year-olds are using Wikipedia, what does this mean for students who are going to come to the university? And I already know everyone's using Wikipedia, so what am I teaching students about Wikipedia? And so it was kind of an aha moment. And then I started talking with others, like, what are the benefits of 9-year-olds using Wikipedia? And the benefits I came up with through brainstorming with my librarian colleagues is that You know, you wouldn't have to log into a database or navigate that confusion of logging into a library database. The students were speaking Spanish and English, so every week they could transition between one or the other language when they're doing their research in Wikipedia. And then we have science librarians like Diana. And so we have a lot of science librarians here. I am not a scientist by any means, but a science librarian told me there's really nowhere you could get introductory information about that many frogs. So it would be the best place to go for introductory information about all these different types of frogs. So upon thinking about it, I decided I really need to learn more about Wikipedia. And then literally just maybe a month after beginning this thought process, I decided the best way for me to learn is to teach a class. That's just how my brain operates. So I decided to propose a class for the Honors College, and I put together the proposal, not knowing all that much about Wikipedia. And then when it was accepted, then I was like, oh my gosh, now I have got to learn everything there is because I'm going to have to teach students about Wikipedia. So I taught the first course in the spring of 2019. And then we hired Diana and around that time. And I asked Diana if she would be interested in teaching it with me. And she said, yes. And then I was the lead teacher that time. And then the most, well, right now we're teaching the class and now Diana is the lead teacher. So before I move on, I see that there's a quick question about the tenure process. No, we are not on temporary contracts. There are two types of librarian in our library. There are professional, called professional staff, and then there's faculty staff. And we are faculty staff, and we go through the same tenure process as faculty in other departments like science or English. So at the conclusion of approximately 6 years, we submit a dossier and we go through a committee in the library, and then it goes up to the university level. And then we get promotion and tenure. And then basically we have a job for life. but you know, there could be consequences if you don't do your job, but it's much like faculty. Okay. So this on the right side, just so you know, is kind of a screenshot of our syllabus. We use kind of a Wikipedia template in the design, and students are able to see the syllabus before they sign up for the class. So now I'm going to hand it over to Diana.
Okay, so as Laurie talked about the beginnings of the class and how it got kind of sprang from her mind and it onto the proposal, and now it's been a part of the curriculum for the past 3 years, which is very exciting. So these are a few of the learning outcomes that we have for the students in the class. And these are ones that we've put on our syllabus and that we've mentioned to, you know, different other faculty who are very curious about why we're teaching Wikipedia, because a lot of people have very preconceived ideas about Wikipedia's role, I guess, in academia. So for the students, we want them to formulate ideas about Wikipedia, about the role of Wikipedia in society, but also in the classroom. And that's what every year the class is different, and this year the students have really focused on why students are discouraged from using Wikipedia. More so because a lot of them are first year students, so they're bringing their high school, secondary school experience with them, but how they've been discouraged. But now they're taking this class where we're teaching them about Wikipedia and telling them that it's okay and that it's actually a good thing to use at times. So there's that kind of imbalance there. The second learning outcome is developing writing skills to effectively communicate academic research to a public audience. A lot of students are very familiar with a type of essay writing that they've learned, but not necessarily how, or even writing a research paper for some of the older students. but not necessarily how to communicate their ideas effectively to an audience that isn't their peers in higher education or their instructors or professors. So writing a Wikipedia article is a great way to learn a different type of writing. The third learning outcome is developing a criteria for evaluating Wikipedia articles and other online information. So this is, as a librarian, we get asked to teach a lot about information literacy and how to evaluate information, whether that's information that's found online or less so now, but in books and other print materials. But using this class as with the Wikipedia assignment as the backdrop, the students go through a process of learning how to find good resources to use, what are the type of information sources that they should be using for their assignment, and also what is being written about what is being written in different mediums, I guess. So in academic journals, in news articles and that sort of thing. So I feel like for a lot of us librarians in higher education, we're asked to do information literacy or database searching, that sort of thing a lot. And in a guest lecture, one-shot context, it's very difficult to evaluate if the students have learned anything or to see if we've made an impact. But with this class, we're building in those skills from the beginning. And the fourth outcome is recognizing the importance of open access information. So a lot of students don't really think about, especially if they have access to a lot of things through their university library, they don't really think about, you know, the cost of a lot of these materials. But working with Wikipedia and seeing how, you know, scholarly publishing is nowadays, I think they really understand the importance of open access and having information available for all. Okay, so this is how our course is delivered. Obviously, we've had to make some changes in the past two classes because of COVID, but there are a few things that have remained the same. One is Canvas, which is our learning management system. We have readings, and the past two classes we've used a tool called Hypothesis. It can be integrated with Canvas, which is great. So the students don't need to move back and forth between different tabs or windows. And it basically is a collaborative annotation software. So they can highlight, they can make comments, they can respond to other classmates. And it's a great way to have text-based discussions that isn't a discussion forum and having them be really disconnected from the reading and the discussion. It can be built right into the reading itself. We found this year, we've used a combination of Hypothesis and in class or via Zoom discussions. And we found that Hypothesis has still been really great for seeing the initial ideas students have about readings. We've gotten some great comments. And it's also a good way to encourage participation from a different variety of learners and students. So not everyone feels comfortable participating via Zoom all the time. You always get the students that are very talkative, whether that's, you know, in person in a classroom or even via Zoom, but some students aren't as comfortable with that. So having Hypothesis opens the avenue of participation in one more way. Our syllabus is also on Canvas, as well as a to-do calendar for different assignments. So that's the readings. And then we also have the Wiki EDU online training modules. So Laurie's going to drop a link to Wiki EDU, but We were talking about this earlier and how a lot of the trainings and teaching about the back end of Wikipedia would be a lot different if we didn't have it. And I think currently it's only available to instructors in North America, or is it, I think it's just the US and Canada maybe, but we're hoping, you know, as they're a very small nonprofit that does work trying to connect Wikipedia to university classrooms. And it's just been a great way for us to have a set of trainings for the students to follow that's very consistent, but also keep track of the work that they're doing. So once they create a username in Wikipedia, we enroll them in the system, and then it keeps track of their contributions, whether they've done the training or not. So it's a great way to have for students to do this assignment. And then, as I mentioned, the past the current class and the last class have been via Zoom. And these are, so developing the class, as I mentioned, one of our learning outcomes is the recognizing the importance of open access information. So we try to keep that in mind as we think about readings for the class. So there is no cost for the students in terms of readings and class materials. So we have chapters from open access textbooks for some of the weeks. We have articles that are not behind paywalls. They are from websites like Wired, where there is a limit to the number of free articles you have available, but there is no upfront cost initially. But this isn't all of the articles. Some of them are from other places, but and then video is available via YouTube. And by that, I mean things like TED Talks. We have some things that have been put together by the Wikimedia Foundation, but they're all available in a format that is accessible to the students. Okay, and so this is kind of the behind the theory and the connecting hands-on portion of this class. So I won't read through every single one of the philosophy and practical aspects of the class, but I think the important parts that we discuss are who edits Wikipedia. So we look at the community of editors at Wikipedia, and we'll go a little bit more in depth into this as we break down our syllabus, but who are the editors of Wikipedia? And for a lot of the students, this isn't something that they've really thought about. You know, we talk about how anyone can edit Wikipedia, and that's kind of a criticism, but also a highlight of Wikipedia as well. But people don't really think beyond, well, if anyone can edit Wikipedia, who is actually editing Wikipedia? And with that, we encourage students, and that's the whole point of this class, right, is that you can edit Wikipedia, and that it, while not as easy as anyone can edit Wikipedia makes it sound, but they have the agency, and after a few training modules, they have the ability to edit Wikipedia. And then I think the important one is, why don't people edit Wikipedia? Oh, sorry, Laurie. Which is kind of a contrast to who edits Wikipedia. And so we, as a critique of the Wikipedia environment and influences in the online community and the infrastructure as well. So. Okay, so as a part of the class, the main assignment or project is the Wikipedia assignment. So we ask students to either start an article from scratch, So that's starting a brand new article that hasn't been in Wikipedia, and this is English Wikipedia. Or they are to create or contribute to a stub article. So that is a small article that is currently in Wikipedia, but needs a lot of work. There needs to be a lot of information that needs to be added to kind of fully flesh out the article into something that is more readable and contains a bit more information. So as you think about this class through the rest of our presentation, these are some reasons why you would incorporate a Wikipedia assignment. It's service learning that has real world value. A lot of students, you know, write an essay that is seen by maybe a couple of peer reviewers and the instructor, but as you'll, if you look at our dashboard, you know, some of these articles have been viewed thousands of times. So there is that immediate impact of their article being seen by a wider audience. It's, you know, it incorporates a lot of different parts of writing, research, media literacy, and critical thinking as students have to go through a process of how they want to incorporate certain sources into their article. They need to see what Wikipedia style is when they write an article, and they need to think about where is the information coming from? Why hasn't this article been there in the first place? Is there a reason for this gap or lack of content? And one thing that we've heard, and that I think it was maybe the first year that Laurie taught this class, was that this assignment is not busy work. So this is not an assignment that, you know, seems like for a lot of other writing classes that you may need to write a certain amount of papers. And sometimes, you know, as students start writing papers, they don't understand the reasoning behind the assignment. But for this assignment, it's very tangible, and they can see that impact right away.
Okay, we put a little question in the chat, which is, have you ever thought of incorporating Wikipedia into your teaching, or have you incorporated Wikipedia into your teaching? So we're curious to learn if folks here have done any work with Wikipedia. Diana, could you drop the link to our dashboard? I realized that I couldn't leave the screen without the problem. And we're going to go through the 10 weeks of our class just to tell you what we focus on each week. We'll only spend about 5 or 6 minutes on this, but of course we could talk forever because we teach a 2-hour class about it every week. But I've put together a document of the readings we do in the class, because librarians often ask what readings we have students do because they want to do the readings. So if you're interested in learning what we read in this class, just follow that link, bit.ly wikicalc. And we've listed them by week, and we're going to be updating them as we continue in the class, because we might make some changes this term. And then we're hoping to write an article sometime this summer about the class, because we've taught it 3 times now, and I think we're ready to write about it. So in week 1, the first week we have students in class, we focus on trolling. And you may think that's odd, but it's a very good hook for the students, because the first reading is One Woman's Brilliant Fuck You to Wikipedia Trolls. That is the title. And I don't know about students in England, but I think students in the US are kind of entertained that university teachers can cuss and like swear. So they're like, oh, this is interesting. So when we read articles about trolling, that creates a lot of really quite interesting conversations amongst the students, because it's immediately eye-opening. They almost always say they had no idea there was trolling in Wikipedia. And so we begin our conversations from there. And also we're setting up the class because there can be and are problems with trolling. So making the students aware that it can happen and that we're here to support them and each other if it should happen. And then, so at the top on these slides about the class, above the line, we're gonna put our readings and what we're doing. But below the line is what the Wiki EDU training modules are for the week. So as we had that picture with the two trees, we have the readings, discussion, kind of philosophy theories, and then the practical trainings. So as Diana mentioned, in this class, we use a tool called Hypothesis, which I love. I have an English degree, and so I like to read and write and think about what I'm reading and writing. And so using Hypothesis, students annotate by kind of like highlighting something, a sentence maybe that makes them think. They highlight it and then they write what they're thinking, and other students can reply to it or create a new annotation. So we thought we'd just include a few slides of what our students have said based on the readings. And so in response to the trolling readings, this is what our students had to say. I had no idea harassment was a problem in Wikipedia. Wiki hounding sounds like no joke, and I can't believe that people go as far as doxing on there. This article really opened my eyes, not only to harassment on Wikipedia, but the larger problem across the internet. The one at the bottom, this is both surprising and unsurprising at the same time, given that a lot of the US is built from a patriarchy and patriarchal notions, it makes sense that Wikipedian editors are male and thus are swayed to share the achievements of men more than women. However, it's surprising because when I click on a Wikipedia page, I never think about the editors. So one of the, I would say, successful parts of teaching about Wikipedia is getting students to really think about the source of their information and who is editing and writing these articles that they're reading. And it really pushes students to think about biases and who creates and disseminates information, even in a free environment like Wikipedia.
Okay, so the second week we talk about neutral point of view, which is, you know, one of Wikipedia's, I think it's one of their pillars. I haven't gone over their pillars this year, but it's, you know, assuming that the article in Wikipedia is not arguing for a certain side. We talk about neutral point of view and what that means for Wikipedia, but we also critique it a little bit as well when we talk about, you know, what is neutrality? What does it mean in Wikipedia? Is it possible to be completely neutral? but also, you know, so a lot of the students, based on the readings and whatnot, see that Wikipedia is not necessarily a neutral place, but we talk about Wikipedia's neutral point of view as kind of a critique and in a sense what that means for their own writing as well. So, and then that week they go through their Wiki EDU module to just evaluate an article. And kind of taking on that more critique lens instead of as just a reader or consumer of the information.
In week three, we discuss disinformation, and we have a short article and an OA textbook chapter. And if you look at the reading Google Doc that we shared, I encourage you to look at the OA textbook that the chapter on disinformation comes from, because there are many chapters in this book. It was just released, I think, a month ago. And I think a lot of librarians will find it useful. And then we also, this week, copy, edit, add to an article. That just means like they're getting practice adding a couple words. But they're really that week, and they're really focused on selecting whatever article they are going to work on. In many classes where professors have students do Wikipedia articles for assignments, the teachers will have some structure to what topic students can pick, or they will even have picked specific articles or to create or work on. But in our class, because we only have up to 12 students, it is a small class, the sky is the limit. So we spend more time with some of the students one-on-one, helping them pick something they're passionate about and that they want to contribute to.
So in week four, we talk about the internet and information inequalities. So we talk about, you know, how information is presented in the US versus other parts of the world. With that, we also kind of are building a bridge to talk more about languages in the following week. So we are considering how information flows globally, you know, out of the US, through the US, and from other countries. And then as a little fun thing, we kind of show three Wikipedia commercials that Laurie found from different countries. And then this year we had them come up with their own commercial. And there are some really great fun ideas from our students about how to convince people in higher education to take Wikipedia seriously. So but they also had some really good critiques, I would say, about why these commercials wouldn't be made in the first place. Thinking about conflicts of interest with the Wikimedia Foundation and how corporations are seen in the US. So that was something that we hadn't really considered, but was a great tangent by our students. So I appreciated that conversation that they had. And this week is the week that they decide on their article topic. It's always a very exciting week. And there's always a little bit of stress for some of the students who, you know, have still not decided, but we try to keep it as open as possible for them and to let them know that, you know, like this isn't a, just because this might be their first article, they don't need to, they don't need to make this the perfect article, and that we want them to choose something that they will enjoy writing for the next 3 to 4 weeks. So, and then important module on avoiding plagiarism, which I think is important in Wikipedia and out of Wikipedia as well. Yeah, so these are some of the comments that some of the students made in the readings that week about information and inequality, and I think languages as well. So I think this week we read an article about language and COVID and how vocabulary is created, specifically in Africa. So some of the students, one of the students said, in my history class in high school, history is written by the victors was often repeated. So I would always keep that in mind in regards to the content I learned in those classes. However, I haven't taken the same approach when reading Wikipedia or other online content. And then the comment in the upper left, I guess reading this has really put things into perspective for me and helped me take a step back and be appreciative for everything. I know English and Spanish, so I have kind of unlimited access to resources compared to someone who only knows the language of their community. So I think we really like hearing a lot of the perspectives of our students because they make such great connections to their own lives and experiences.
So the next week we focus on non-English languages and the internet, which is Wikipedia is perfect for that because it's available in over 300 languages. I would say this is my favorite weekend because as you may know, the US is really a country that is monolingual despite the fact that we have the second highest number of Spanish speakers in the world. Nonetheless, the education system is very much built around English. Most adults are monolingual. So often this is the first time students have really thought about other languages beyond maybe English and or Spanish. And so we have some great conversations. And we also bring in someone from the Wikimedia Foundation who lives in Peru. So she has videoed in every term we've taught the class for the past 3 years. So she's a great addition to the class.
Yeah, and then this is actually our current week, so week 6, we start discussing gender bias. And this is something that's been kind of peppered throughout some of the other articles that students have read. This week, they are only reading one article and a short video because the important assignment for this week is they start a peer review of their article drafts. So if you have a chance to look at the readings in the link that Laurie provided, I would highly recommend that you all read the reading for this week. Really takes a look at the infrastructure of Wikipedia and the technology and how that is very gendered and excludes women, their perspectives and their contributions. So I would highly recommend that reading.
And then we'll just go quickly through these since we're running out of time, but we kind of go from really a focus on Wikipedia and then start really discussing the internet in a broader perspective in these last few weeks. So in week 7, we discuss algorithms. I feel like we're still honing, like tweaking this one a little bit, but we watch a little video about what is an algorithm because we have students from all majors and a lot of students frankly don't know the basics of coding nor algorithms, so they need a little introduction. And then we do a reading on from that open access textbook that I mentioned, and we do one article read about bots in Wikipedia. And here they begin moving their articles to the main space on Wikipedia.
So I saw a question, or Suzanne had mentioned some questions about Wikipedia and censorship in China. We actually haven't had to deal with that in this current term or the previous term where we've taught via Zoom. The students have been, I would say almost all of them were scattered somewhere through the US. So we haven't had to deal with Wikipedia being censored in China. We do talk about it during this week and how Wikipedia has been censored throughout the years, how that has changed when they moved to HTTPS. And currently it's only blocked in China. So that's a really good question. And I don't know how we would have dealt with that if we had a student who is currently in China. That is something for us to think about.
I, as an international librarian, I have had students from China in the blocked sites, and they're using the VPN to get around it, to get to the OSU resources that they need to use. Also, I wanted to talk real quickly about our guest speaker is Olga Karelia. And I met Olga in 2017 when she and I were speaking at IFLA together. We were paired together at a presentation. And she is got a PhD in international law, and her specialty is digital human rights. And her passion is educating young people about their digital rights. So she has just volunteered to come and talk to our students every year, and she's phenomenal and really interested in talking about censorship with students. And she's based in the Ukraine, so she has a special perspective as well. And then last but not least, for our week topics is privacy. And we have a librarian, Kelly McElroy. She's also very into critical librarianship, so you may have seen her name around, but she focuses a lot of work, her own work on privacy. So she comes and talks to our students about Wikipedia and privacy, but also just maintaining their own privacy wherever they are on the web. And this is also the week where students wrap up their articles and begin preparing for a presentation.
And the last week is a very celebratory week. We get to hear from the students about their process. They get to present their articles to the class. So if their classmates haven't seen their articles, this is a great way to wrap up the class. So this is always one of my favorite moments of the class, to just kind of hear from everyone and just hear about their process and how they decided on certain things and whatnot. So, and I do see their...
Oh, also, the way we frame the assignment is that we tell students that when they go and get a job after school, they're going to have to tell their coworkers in meetings what they're up to and how they're what they've been doing the last few weeks. And so to frame it in that context, that this is a presentation that's like a conversation in a way where you're going to tell us why you picked what you picked, what you learned, what you enjoyed about it, what you didn't enjoy. I mean, without a doubt, this is always the most memorable class because it's kind of surprising still to me how excited students are when they're giving these presentations, because they usually do pick something they're very passionate about. So Diana and I learn a lot during the presentations and take lots of notes like about what they say.
So these are from two of our reflections from last year. And I just want to talk about the one in the left corner. So I found so many STEM articles that relate to my major, and now I feel empowered to work on them. The only thing I fear is I will lose my access to OSU's library and the connected library systems after I graduate. This is why we need organizations like Wikipedia so we can access information without a $60 paywall for each article. I felt like that comment from the student concisely wraps up, you know, the importance of Wikipedia, of having open access, other sources of open access information beyond, you know, the scholarly publishing landscape. So it was just so to, as an instructor, to read that from a student, I was like, yes, yes. And seeing that and, you know, just kind of affirms our belief in why this is important. So we just want to talk about our course and centering marginalized voices. We, as two women, teach this course. Three of our guest speakers are women, and the majority of our assigned readings are authored by women, which is very much in contrast to the landscape of Wikipedia editors and being about, you know, I think their last, I think they always estimate it's like 85 to 90% male editors in English Wikipedia. So very much a contrast to what the editor demographics are like currently. But there's always room for improvement. We, you know, are very lacking in our readings or even some of the videos. We would like more content from BIPOC contributors. And one thing that I would like to make space for is to talk more about race and racism. It's kind of implied and discussed in a few of our readings, but it is, especially from a US context, I think important to talk about. And you know, this is something that Wikipedia doesn't have that much data on, but I think is still important in the context of the internet and online community and just being a citizen in general. So these are our stats from the past three classes. In 2019, we had 12 students and about 18,500 words. In 2020, we had 10 students and we had about 16,300 words. And then this year we have 11 students and our word count is still yet to be determined, but we're very excited to see what that becomes. And these are, you know, words that have we always tell the students these are words that would not have been in Wikipedia if not for their contributions. So they have contributed to a landscape where thousands of other people are reading and accessing, and their contributions are being seen from around the world. Yeah, so thank you so much for attending. We do see the raised hands and the questions. So now, you know, we would like to open it up and see what questions you have for us.
Yes, Rachel, perhaps you'd like to ask your question.
Actually, it was more of a comment. The chat function seems to be disabled. So that's maybe why nothing's been coming through for a while. But I haven't been able to write anything, and I don't know if anybody else has. That's just what I wanted to point out. Sorry about that.
Well, that may be a problem then. Can people indicate, if they can't indicate in the chat, perhaps they could speak up and say that the chat...
Yeah, I'll put my hand down now. Sorry.
No, yeah, it's disabled. Yes, it's disabled.
So okay. we weren't being too quiet.
Okay, my apologies. I'm not sure how that could have happened, but please put your hands up if you would like to ask a question. Paito, you've got a question.
Hello, thank you so much. Yes, by the way, loved your presentation. Fascinating. Should perhaps say that I'm a final year list student over at UCL. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can.
Fantastic. So sorry, Susan, I couldn't get back to you because the chat was disabled. So the thing was coming up, but I couldn't type. My question was, because we did sort of similar sort of, I remember doing similar class as part of the list degree over at UCL. Something that I remembered from it was doing like a comparison to different searches and for instance, having Wikipedia in one window and something like DuckDuckGo search engine in the other, and just seeing what sort of differences the algorithms produce. And I was wondering if you incorporate that in your teaching or if that's at all important to essentially explain the difference between different search engine algorithms and how the Wikipedia articles using certain keywords or key terms can sort of feed into them. I hope that makes sense.
Yes, it does. So in the week where we discuss disinformation, one of the activities we do is lateral reading, which is something that is just gaining more attention in the US quite recently. So we do an exercise of lateral reading where we have students open an article, and then it's not a Wikipedia article, but an article from a source that they don't know. And then they engage in lateral reading and we come together as a group to discuss what they found. But when we get to the week on algorithms, then we will be discussing search results and why does Wikipedia come to the top. And one of our students told us last week that he had heard Wikipedia is the top result because Wikipedia pays Google to always be the top result. And he asked that right before we had our speaker from the Wikimedia Foundation. So we were able to ask her and then she debunked that myth. But I like your idea. It's a great idea, which we haven't done.
So I see that there's a question in the chat about dealing with trolling and have we ever had to put that in action? I'm going to say with our students, we have not, but Laurie has experienced some of that fairly recently. If you want to talk about it, Laurie.
Well, an example that I have that happened recently that we may discuss in class is I come to Wikipedia, as you know, as an educator more than as a writer or editor, but I do create articles about Black history in Oregon because it's just a huge gap. And I'm also from Nebraska, which is a state in the middle of the country. So I'd created an article about an incident in the middle of the country about a young Black woman being killed in the 1960s. And someone came along and I capitalized the word Black and not the word white, which is the current Associated Press standard. And someone came along and took the word Black and made the first letter lowercase. And then I went and looked at that user's page and they are engaging in the same activity across Wikipedia, going in and changing. They obviously have an axe to grind, as we would say. So we'll be talking about microaggressions and how that can be played out and discourage people from editing Wikipedia. But we've not had any major trolling, no.
And I will say that a lot of these student assignments are stamped with this is part of a student, a class as part of a WikiEDU thing. So there is some sort of, I wouldn't say protection, but sometimes people, some Wikipedia editors are very quick to delete or discount certain contributions from, you know, new editors. And I think having this as part of a class protects the students a little bit in that way, so that people know that this is a student contribution and that this, you know, may not be complete at the moment, that sort of thing.
I have a question, Laurie and Diana. I know you said that faculty academics were a bit surprised that you were actually teaching Wikipedia. Are students referring in their references to Wikipedia articles more? And how has that been received by faculty or academics?
We don't encourage students to cite Wikipedia. Instead, we discuss how everything in Wikipedia should be cited itself. And whenever you're doing research, you should go to the original source and cite the original source. So technically, there should be no reason to cite Wikipedia. But I haven't heard anything from faculty about students doing that, because across the board, I can't imagine our students would do that, because it seems like the only thing they hear in school before college is don't cite Wikipedia. So that's not an issue at this point. I see Leah is talking about the One Lib One Ref campaign, and that she does some organizing via Teams. And we at our library are not involved in One Lib One Ref, but of course it's a huge effort and great work goes into that. We, Diana, myself, and another librarian, archivist librarian, we organize edit-a-thons. So we do 2 edit-a-thons every year. But yes, many librarians enjoy and get involved with One Lib One Ref.
I see that there's a question about students' work being removed, and that has happened a couple of times. So we don't, penalize them for having their work removed. The point of the article is not necessarily that, you know, it needs to be viewed hundreds of, or thousands of times, or that it needs to stick. It's more of the process to get to the article and to write it. And it's been, you know, we've had a couple of different cases of why it's been removed. Usually it has happened after the class. So it's after the students have left us. So we can't really have a discussion with them about, you know, what was the reasoning behind the removal, but it has happened.
And how do we assess the work? Well, the class is what's called pass, no pass. So they don't get a grade for the class. They just pass it or they don't pass it. And that coupled with the fact that they are honor students and coupled with the fact that Wikipedia is peer reviewed. So they're getting feedback from other Wikipedians. It means that they, we require them to write 800 words, but they usually write like 1,500, because I just looked at them last night from last year. And we haven't had any problems with quality or with anyone not passing. It's fine. I don't know how it would be in a class that's bigger or where there is a grade assigned.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Laurie and Diana. That's really generated a lot of conversation there once we got the chat going. So thank you so much. That was a really interesting approach to teaching Wikipedia or teaching evaluation of sources. And I saw that Maria King put in the chat that she'll be talking about sort of teaching of Wikipedia in her session tomorrow. So we look forward to that. So I'm going to close the session now to enable everyone to transfer over to the summing up end of the first day by Michelle and Darren.